Hello, wonderful people. Welcome to Cosmology Talks. Today we have Minh Nguyen, who is a research fellow at Leinweber Center for Theoretical Physics in Michigan. He's talking today about a combination of S8 clustering, modified gravity, and peculiar velocities. But what he finds is that by including the chance to modify gravity within all of these constraints, it looks to me like a kind of what one would expect the resolution to the S8 tension to actually look like. Though, of course, as with all results, we should allow them to withstand scrutiny before announcing them as the result. And, of course, modified gravity is a bold thing to be declaring. This is super interesting to me, and so interesting I'm going to do something I've never done before. I'm going to put a plot on the screen right now, which is their gamma, the modified gravity parameter that I'm sure Min will introduce, versus sigma 8, and showing really that when you go into this gamma dimension, the Planck and local clustering gator really does seem to just align in exactly the way you'd expect the resolution to the S8 tension to be. So what I'm actually care to hear from Min today in particular is why this might be wrong. Like why can't we just celebrate that we've solved the tension? But I'm sure he also wants to talk about why maybe we have solved the tension, but I'm certainly going to badger him on why we might not have. But yeah, welcome Min. Do you want to start by telling us briefly about your paper?
Sure. Thank you for the invitation. So the idea of this paper is very simple. So as the universe evolves, the homogeneity background expands, and the inhomogeneities in matter distribution, on the other hand, collapse. So then, and then from large scale structure in the universe. So in this work, we test the consistency or lack thereof between the history of the growth of structure and the history of the expansion of this cosmic background within lambda CDM and general relativity, the current cosmological model. So we do so by modeling the growth rate of structure using this very precise parameterization, the so-called growth index or gamma parameterization. This allowed us to, within linear theory and in principle, separate the effects of the expansion of the backgrounds from that of growth. So specifically, we analyzed the CMB data from the Planck 2018 public release tree. For large-scale structure, we use F sigma 8 data from a combination of peculiar velocity and redshift space distortion measurements. We also use the baryonic acoustic oscillation measurements from 6-degree galaxy field survey and the Sloan digital sky survey. And finally, we use the 3-by-2-point correlation functions between galaxy and galaxy lensing from the dark energy survey year one release. So analyzing these data sets, we find a similar, if not identical, expansion history that was reported in the fiducial analysis of the aforementioned data set. Given this history, however, we find that the evidence for a suppression of the growth of structure fairly recently following the onset of dark energy. And what is perhaps interesting is that this suppressed growth offer a new interpretation for the two current tensions in the current cosmological data, which is the S8 tension, as you mentioned at the beginning, between CMB and large-scale structure probes, and also more specific to Planck is the reference for a closed universe or an abnormally high CMB lensing amplitude.
Cool. So if someone is remembering this video or your paper 6 months or a year from now, and they only remember two things, what would you want those two things to be?
So I would say the first key observation is that it's not just one or two single data points or data sets that prefer this suppressed growth, but it's rather all the combinations of the data sets that we looked at collectively point towards this suppression of growth. And then the second takeaway I would say is that this offer, again, a new interpretation in S8 tension and the tension between the Planck CMB data and the rest of the large-scale structure data.
Although I guess you don't really have an impact on the H0 tension either way. Like it doesn't make it worse, but it also doesn't make it better.
Maybe I should just rephrase that as the specifically at the curvature and CMB lensing tension.
Cool. So why did you do this? I guess perhaps everything S8 tension is already well motivated, but why these particular data sets and why the growth rate parameter, and why was this only possible now? Like it seems kind of obvious once you look at the paper. Why did someone not do this 3 years ago what were we waiting for in terms of data or theory?
So actually, the story behind this paper is not really straightforward. It doesn't really have a beginning where we said that we're going to investigate whether the growth rate or growth history deviates from that predicted by general relativity. I think it's more of a random chain of events. I was coming to the University of Michigan with my background doing kinematic Soon-Zeldovic effect. In the CMB, I was interested in using this as a new prop for the growth rate of structure. And then, you know, Dragan Hüterer, the second author, and then also my postdoc advisor, he was writing up this review about using growth to get cosmological constraints. And then also the Yu Wei Wen, a finishing PhD student of Dragan, she was studying the effects of dark energy and modified gravity and whether or not we can correctly interpret what is actually driving the cosmic expansion history. And then so we just happened to be in the same room, and then we said, let's do something together. And so so we were sort of like looking for a new parameterization of growth rate, which is even more generalized than the growth index that we are using in this paper for a much broader class of modified gravity models, usually known as the Hornensky class of modified gravity. And then it was going well. And then, of course, before we could try to use this new parameterization, we would like to actually test the old parameterization. So since it was claimed that it is so accurate, and then we also want to, of course, test our implementation. So we said, let's do real data inference with just the constant growth index gamma. And this is what we found. So it's actually also a surprise for us.
And so you wrote it up rather than waiting until you'd done the more detailed analysis, which makes sense. Did you do the analysis blind or?
No, we didn't do it blind. So this is a peek into our results, but also to answer your question of why now instead of like 2 or 3 years earlier. So on the top panel, is the measurements of F sigma 8 as a function of redshift. As shown at the data points with arrow bars for a number of measurements, including using the peculiar velocity or the redshift speed distortion and BL from galaxies clustering. And the black curve is the Planck measurement for F sigma 8, showing for omega m of 0.3. And then the dashed red curve is the same F sigma 8 quantity, but for omega m of 0.25. And this is from the review by Dragan.
And I guess people who aren't familiar with what F is might be wondering. It's there on your second figure if people are wondering, but I presume you'll also go into more detail about what F is later in the talk. But if people are wondering, it is actually there on the screen at the moment.
Yeah, I was just continue to say that looking at this figure, you can see that omega m sort of fix the cosmic expansion history and then the overall amplitude of F sigma 8. But then I was looking at this plot and then I start to wonder, given the same expansion history, can you have a different F sigma 8 measurement if you change just the growth history? And that is what happens in the bottom panel. So if given the same omega m but with a different growth history, here parameterized by this growth rate, growth index gamma, then you can end up with sort of the same overall amplitude, but then a tilt in the fairly low redshift range of F sigma 8. And the reason that this paper was written now instead of 3 years ago is because since the Planck 2018 paper, we have some new measurements of F sigma 8 coming first at the very low redshift, so the local universe, from peculiar velocity. I'm highlighting these three recent measurements going in descending order of time. So Turner, Said, and Borua, they are using, the first two are using 6-degree field galaxy surveys with or without the Sloan Digital Sky Survey data. And then Borua was using the 2M++ galaxy catalog. Also, we on the high redshift, intermediate redshift range, we have the new measurements from EBOS data using emission light galaxies. So I think together these three give us a compelling reason to redo this analysis. Because in fact, this kind of analysis that use the growth rate parameterization, gamma parameterization of growth rate was already done in the past a few times, which we also mentioned in the paper. And the interesting thing for me, or interesting observation for me, was that very few of these analyses found lower growth index than the 0.55 predicted by lambda CDM. They usually find gamma north of 0.55. It's just that the constraints wasn't so great to claim that there was a significant evidence for a suppression of growth.
I mean, I guess looking at this plot at large redshift, where maybe the bulk of the earlier measurements were made, the difference is expected to be smaller.
Yeah, I mean, it will become clearer as we go to through the results, but we did some quick tests where we would leave some of these data points out. What we found is that the conclusion is fairly robust. And then also here, I would like to highlight that we are not using only Aₑₑₑ₈ measurements, not only these data points, but also the, for example, the Planck CMB data. So the final result is not just driven by these data points, for example.
Yeah, let's get into the details now. How did you use this data, and how did you constrain it, and what is F sigma 8? Why is gamma 0.55 in general relativity?
Before we start, a little bit of background. So as I mentioned earlier, matter density fluctuations in our universe grows over time. As you can see, looking at this animation of an n-body simulation with dark matter, you can see that as time evolves, as we get to lower and lower redshift, structure collapses. And then in the linear regime, we can describe this growth of structure by a very simple equation, which is driven, and this growth is driven by just this, how much matter is there to cluster, and then it's also damped by the friction caused by the cosmic background expansion. So the linear growth can be characterized by the linear growth factor in this very simple equation, and then the linear growth rate is just the derivative of the growth factor. In our approach, we parameterize this linear growth rate, trying to separate between the cosmic background expansion that is entirely now encoded within the omega m parameter, and then on the effect of the growth history is now encoded in the so-called growth index gamma. This parameterization goes back to Linder and even before that, and the idea is what I just told you, trying to separate the effects of cosmic background expansion and the growth of structure. In this plot, I'm showing the power spectrum as a function of the wave number k. This is produced by the standard Boltzmann solver CAM and the modified CAM where we introduce this parameterization, but we fix the growth index to the value predicted by general relativity, which is 0.55. And you can see that this parameterization produces a very good approximation to what is predicted by general relativity by solving the full coupled Boltzmann equation.
Can I ask a question at this point? So this gamma being 0.55, is that actually just general relativity? Or has it also got some lambda CDM-ish assumptions in there? Or if I had a modified lambda CDM but still had general relativity and omega m as a function of scale factor was different, but it was still general relativity, like let's say dark energy was doing something funky, it had an equation of state or something, is gamma then still 0.55 just because it's general relativity? Is that right?
So that's a very good question. So within lambda CDM, 0.55 is a very good approximation. I think up to 0.2% for a good range of omega m, and also, as you mentioned, for a good range of the equation of state w, as long as this is a constant. Of course, for modified gravity, then the value of gamma would change, for example, in DGP or in other scenarios. But for lambda CDM, within lambda CDM, this is a very good approximation. So I already showed this plot earlier. I would like just to highlight again now that looking at the top panel, you can see that the effect of omega m is sort of fixing the background expansion history and then fixing the overall amplitude of f sigma 8, why the effects of growth parameterized in the growth index gamma will change the tilt or the shape of this F sigma 8 as a function of redshift. Yeah, so just to now move to the data that we used. So we use, first of all, CMB data from the Planck collaboration, specifically their data released in 2018, which includes polarization and temperature anisotropies. However, these anisotropies that we observe or measure are not the primary anisotropies. Instead, on their ways towards us, these CMB photons are actually gravitationally lensed by the structure between the last scattering surface and our detectors. So the effect of this gravitational lensing that I'm showing here is essentially smooth out the angular power spectrum of the primary CMBs, as shown in the bottom left panel. You can see that going from black to red or orange, it is artificially increase the amplitude of this effect. So trying to increase the amount of matter between the CMB and us. And you can see the effect is basically smoothing these acoustic peaks in the CMB. So this sort of information needs to be taken into account when you model the CMB. And then you can also use this information to reconstruct the potential, the gravitational potential of this matter distribution, and try to infer the, for example, the growth of structure from this sort of information. On the plot on the bottom right panel, I'm showing exactly the angular power spectrum of this deflection potential reconstructed by the Planck team in 2018. And then what is important to keep in mind for our analysis is that because the growth index parameterization was only validated for subhorizon and linear regime, we tried to isolate the effect of a varying growth index gamma from the primordial unlensed CMB anisotropies. So all the effects of a varying gamma only acts to modify the CMB lensing potential, whether it enters the modeling of the observed or lensed CMB or the reconstructed CMB lensing potential.
So you mean modifying gamma doesn't affect the primordial temperature stuff, just the lensing? Is that what you're...
Yes. So in the analysis, there are the CMB lensing likelihood, and then there is also the CMB temperature and polarization likelihoods. So in the CMB temperature and polarization likelihoods, there's the effect of CMB lensing is also taken into account. So our modification of gamma enters into this CMB lensing modeling. So that's the first place. And then the second place it enters for CMB data is whenever we consider the CMB lensing likelihood, which try to infer cosmology from the CMB lensing, reconstructed CMB lensing potential.
I mean, yeah, that makes sense, right? The idea that a modification of structure growth in the late universe, one wouldn't naively expect that to change anything else in the CMB, unless, of course, there's some underlying model that is causing the growth change now that would also then affect the early universe. But I guess that's something one has to consider on a model by model basis.
That's right. And then I think that one would also need to find another way to take that into account more consistently, because I think it's also important to keep in mind that this growth index or gamma parameterization is just an approximation, and therefore try to isolate it within this regime where it is valid. So moving on to the large scale structure side. So we used various F sigma 8 measurements from various sources. One such sources is the use of peculiar velocity. And the main idea is very simple. It's just that you need some simultaneous determinations of the redshift and distance to some objects. Knowing redshift and distance, you can convert that into the peculiar velocity of these objects by subtracting out the Hubble flow coming from the cosmic background expansion. So here in this plot, I'm showing the local F sigma A measurements in recent years, summarized by Turner in his paper in 2023. I think the black and red data points are from the 6-degree field galaxy surveys. The blue ones are not, and then the yellow ones are the ones that use velocity reconstruction to measure F sigma 8 in this analysis, because there are various ways you can infer F sigma 8 from peculiar velocity data. You can use some sort of scaling relations like fundamental plan for elliptical galaxies or Tully Fisher for spiral galaxies, or just directly use a distant indicator like the Taiwan A supernovae. And then I'm highlighting, in addition, the data points that we use in this analysis in red, which are the five measurements. Some of them use the same data, for example, 6-degree galaxy field surveys, but because there doesn't exist a covariance, nor a good way to estimate the covariance between these measurements, we essentially assume that they are independent.
And would one, so they're using different supernovae for them to be independent? And if the two that are from the 6-degree field, I would have imagined weren't independent, but...
So they all come from the same galaxy survey, but they use different approaches to model this distant and peculiar velocity. For example, I think Hilterer used Taiwan A supernova, for example. White, Bellet et al, I have to look it up, but I think used... instead galaxy clustering. And then Turner also used velocity and galaxy clustering, so sort of like velocity galaxy cross correlation. I think, for example, Said also used 6-degree field galaxy survey in combination with Sloan digital Chi survey, but I think they use the fundamental plan relation. So these measurements use different distant indicators and different modeling approach. I think the reassurance thing here is that they sort of come up with F sigma 8 measurements that are in broad agreement between each other.
And your use of these, do you just like multiply all the likelihoods together, or how do you use these five different data sets?
So that's what I meant when I say that we assumed that the these data points are independent, such that the covariance are diagonal. Admittedly, it would be much better if you can account for the covariance matrix between these data points, but also I don't know a priori if there exists any covariance or there is any way to consistently model this covariance. So what we did later is that we tried to drop out one at a time these data points, and or even two, trying to see if they affect our conclusion in the end.
And on the previous plot, you obviously showed F sigma 8 depends on redshift, but here on one plot, you're putting all the values. Has this been extrapolated to redshift zero, or should these be slightly different because they're at different redshifts?
So these measurements are extrapolated to redshift zero. So that's what I meant when I say local measurements of F sigma 8. And I didn't put the F sigma 8 of Z on the title.
So even though some of the measurements might have been at redshift 0.5 or 0.6 or something, you then use the model to extrapolate to what it would mean for F sigma 8 at Z equals zero.
So I should also have clarified that these peculiar velocity measurements go to fairly low redshift. So I think all of them are below 0.1. Some of them even claim to be like 0.02 or something. So they are effectively local. So now I'm coming to the F sigma 8 measurements as a function of redshift. So these extend to much higher redshift. And the reason for that is that they use the redshift space distortion effect. The idea is, again, very similar to what I just said for peculiar velocity. It's just that now instead of trying to get the distance directly from the velocity, then now you use the effect of peculiar velocity on the clustering of galaxies to infer F sigma 8. And the effect of the peculiar velocity on the clustering of galaxies is illustrated here on the left, where in real space, galaxies can, on large scale, collapse into overdense regions. And then this sort of have a quashing effect on the clustering of galaxies that is known as the Kaiser effect. And that is the effect that is relevant for our analysis, for the analysis of F sigma 8 and for our purpose. I think Johannes also mentioned this and explained it very well in his talk, in cosmology talks a few weeks ago. And so on the right, I'm showing the measurement of redshift space distortion used in the Sloan Digital Chi survey, in particular, I think EBOS data for emission light galaxies, because we are essentially measuring the anisotropic clustering of galaxies. It's also complementary that we model and infer the baryonic acoustic oscillation together with this effect. Baryonic acoustic oscillation is the imprint of baryonic density waves in the primordial fluctuations onto the clustering of galaxies. Because of this complementary property, we also include BO data in our analysis. And all the data and likelihoods that we use are available at this GitHub repo that essentially a fork from the Cobaya repo. So finally, we also use the 3 by 2 points correlation functions from dark energy survey. So these correlation functions essentially measure the correlations between the position of galaxies, so the so-called galaxy-galaxy, and then the correlation between how background galaxies are sheared on the sky due to gravitational lensing, so the so-called shear-shear correlation, and then finally the correlation between the background sheared galaxies and the position of the foreground galaxies, so the so-called galaxy-galaxy lensing. We combine this data vector with BO and F sigma 8 in our analysis to try to constrain the growth index explicitly by only large scale structure data. So finally, we come to the constraints on the growth index specifically. So this plot is showing the 1D materialized constraints on the growth index gamma, and using two combinations. The red one is F sigma 8 measurements together with the Planck CMB data, and then the purple one is basically everything we consider. The vertical dashed line shows the gamma of 0.55 as predicted by general relativity and lambda CDM. As you can see, we exclude this prediction by 4.2 sigma for the F sigma 8 and Planck combination, why when you combine all the data, it is only 3.7 sigma. So what does this imply? Again, we're returning to this plot. So a higher gamma essentially tells you that you have a lower growth rate. And then when you look at the proxy for growth rates in the usual proxy for growth rates in these large scale structure measurements, which is F sigma 8, then you also see the same thing, which is a suppressed growth rate, in this case at within redshift of 0 and 0.6. Now, finally, what does this imply for other cosmological parameters? Can you relate it to any other tension, or can you find any hint for a higher growth index or suppressed growth in any previous literature? We think the answer is yes. So looking at this plot, we're showing the 2D constraints on the y-axis, the growth index gamma, and then on the x-axis from left to right, the S8, so matter fluctuations, amplitude as usually constrained by weak lensing surveys, and then the omega m, the matter parameter, and then the finally the Hubble parameter, H0. Looking at the plot on the most left, you can immediately notice that when you fix gamma to 0.55, then there seems to be a tension between the S8 value inferred by large scale structure data sets, in this case F sigma 8, DS year 1 and BO, compared to the same value inferred by the Planck CMB data, which is shown by the horizontal bars on this plot. This tension is famous enough that I don't think I need to say any more words on this. And now if you instead allow for gamma to vary, as we did, so you sort of say that the growth history can deviate from the prediction by general relativity and lambda CDM, then you can see that this gamma sort of works both constraints from Planck and large-scale structure towards each other, in the sense that it brings the SA constraints from Planck to lower value, while the SA constraints by large-scale structure data shifts to higher value. So this effectively resolves the SA tension, while in the other two panels, you can see that we don't find a significant any significant shift or change or further tension in the constraints on the matter parameter omega m and the Hubble constant H0.
Out of curiosity, because I didn't read your paper closely enough, or maybe it's just not there, but you have the equivalent of this result in a table where you've just got Planck and F sigma 8. Did you do it with just Planck and DESI 01 plus BAO at all? How much of this is, like, would it have a similar look if you removed F sigma 8 from this? I'm just curious, because people have done beyond lambda CDM with DESI 01 and BAO. Presumably they've also checked for gamma. Maybe they haven't. And I don't remember seeing anyone say that gamma fixes the S8 tension in that respect. So I guess what I was worried about deep in the back of my mind was that DES year one plus BAO on its own would still be in tension with Planck, even when you allow gamma to change. But somehow F sigma 8 is sufficiently constraining that it's pulling the DES data up. That in a sense, F sigma 8 and DES might be in tension with each other. But I mean, I'm only speculating on this on sociological reasons, that I haven't seen a paper claiming that DES year one is evidence for gamma. So I'm not doing this on any physical basis. It's pure sociological.
No, but I think your concern is valid. And I think, I don't know if I prepare that plot here, but I think we showed also a table of chi-square in our paper. And you can sort of see that when you consider together the combination F sigma 8, DAS and BAO, then the fit is, I think the fit is not as good as the improvement in the goodness of fit between freeing gamma and gamma of 0.55 is not as great as you can see when you consider just F sigma 8 alone. So you might be right in the sense that when you consider F sigma 8 together with DS and BO, the likelihood has to work towards reconcile these two so that the improvement is no longer as great as just F sigma 8.
I've got your paper open in front of me, and so I'll put the table in the video. I guess what you're talking about is lines 2 and 3 of this table. The delta chi squared is minus 13.6 for Planck plus F sigma 8 and minus 13.2 when you add DESI 1 and BAO. So it sort of matches my concern, like the goodness if it doesn't improve, but it also doesn't drastically decrease. It doesn't go from minus 13.6 to minus 2 or something, saying that would then tell me, look, there's massive tension. If anything, this is just telling me there's very, very little constraining power at all, I guess, for some reason. So that's interesting. Okay. But it's not in huge tension.
Yes. So actually we just had that table as a reference, but then we ended up liking it a lot because it sort of like explains your concern, answers your concern, or you know, like showing people fully what is happening behind the scene between these data sets.
I think what I was asking for was one more line, which was Planck 18 plus DES plus BAO, but without F sigma 8. That was the line that I wanted.
Another question that we also we were also curious about is that we know that the Planck 2018 data showed a preference for a closed universe, which is a positively curved space, so negative omega k, which is the curvature parameter, or abnormally high CMB lensing amplitude, so a lens higher than 1, which is expected if gravity is described by general relativity. So in this plot, we actually look at the residuals between best fit models in three scenarios. So freeing gamma, freeing omega k, or freeing a lens, with respect to the best fit model for lambda CDM and GR, of course. And what we found is that all of these residuals follow exactly the same oscillatory pattern that also happens to be the pattern in the residuals between the data, the actual Planck data, and the best fit lambda CDM model. So I think what we are saying here is essentially these preferences be it high gamma or negative omega k or high A length, is essentially driven for Planck data by the same data feature. And actually, as you can see on the minor plot that I include here in the bottom right, you can trace a negative omega k with a lower gamma. So essentially saying that if you want to stick to gamma of 0.55, then you end up with a negative omega k, but you can also bring back omega k to zero if you allow for gamma to deviate from 0.55 towards higher value, as we found in our analysis.
You do also, like, going back to this table that you said you only decided to include at the last minute, it's a very good table. You also have just the Planck 18 with gamma, and there's like a delta chi squared of minus 2.8. So there is even a tiny bit of evidence, and I guess it's coming from exactly this. There's a tiny bit of evidence for gamma, even in just Planck, like forgetting about the local data, just Planck, which is, I guess, coming from this alien stuff.
Yeah, I think the Planck data alone also showed some mute preference for gamma. But I think when we talk about Planck data, and especially when we discuss about omega k, it's better to separate between the Planck temperature and polarization likelihoods and the CMB lensing likelihoods. So if you just consider, for example, in this case, as I'm showing, the Planck temperature and polarization data, then I think the omega k scenario is slightly favored compared to the higher gamma case. But if you bring back the CMB lensing, then I think higher gamma is slightly favored compared to omega k, negative omega k. So I think there's a trade-off, but essentially, as we said in the paper, we think that both models or both scenarios, a suppressed growth or a negative omega k, fits the data equally well.
When I've seen people talk about aliens in the past, and this omega curvature as well, but mainly aliens, it's always a bit mysterious because, okay, one super naive interpretation one might give for aliens is, okay, there's just more lensing, full stop, move on. But then the lensing reconstruction potentials don't want more lensing. So it's not so simple. But it seems like something you're doing now is working. Is that a correct thing to say? That somehow you're not, or you are also fitting the lensing reconstruction? For example, when I look at this table and you've got the PL18, is that just temperature and polarization, or does that have lensing as well?
So it's a good place to clarify that in the paper, whenever you just see PL18, then it includes lensing. And whenever you see PL18 temp plus pole, then it's temperature and polarization only.
I remember seeing figures where they go just temp and polarization. And I guess the plot you've got on the inset plot is exactly an example like this. Seems to favor curvature or some sort of modification of lambda CDM. But then when you add the lensing reconstruction potential back in, everything kind of gets pulled back to lambda CDM. But for some reason, you're not seeing that with gamma. It's still favoring a large gamma. Is that correct? And do you have any physical inkling as to what's different about gamma?
Right. So I think we also didn't find any strong reference by the CMB lensing likelihoods for gamma, actually, if you look at the chi-square table. But yeah, I don't think I would go as far as claiming that a higher gamma model fits the CMB lensing likelihood much better than the lambda CDM. But I would just say that the higher gamma model fits the CMB lensing likelihood slightly better than the negative curvature scenario.
Okay. And therefore, its improvement on the temperature and polarization is not undone by its effect on the lensing potential, whereas the curvature is sort of undone when you add the lensing. Like the improvement on one is cancelled by. Okay.
Right. I think the one of the papers you are having in mind is probably the Di Valentino paper, which I think they did show that when you add lensing, then the improvements in chi-square is drastically undone. Yes.
Do you have a physical intuition for what is different?
Well, I just for the case of a higher gamma, I think the interpretation is actually simple, is that it is similar to having a higher lensing amplitude, for example. It's just because for a higher gamma and the same amount of structure that you observe today, you would have to have more structure in the past. And then, so there's more structure in the past, so you would have a higher Lensing amplitude. So that is the, this is our interpretation for a higher gamma. Now I would just return to your question that whether our data, our conclusion, our result is driven by any of the data points, in particular the peculiar velocity data, because I know that in within the community there is a very strong skepticism for peculiar velocity data because they have to face or encounter a lot of systematics. But here we as I said, we cannot come up with any model for the covariance. So what we could do is that we one at a time exclude some F sigma 8 data points from these peculiar velocity measurements. In this plot, I'm showing again the fiducial results in red, and then in blue and green, we exclude the Turner and Said measurements. And finally, in gray, we just say basically, let's exclude all the F sigma 8 measurements together. One thing you can see is that the central values of gamma is always north of 0.55, actually quite consistent between these combinations of data. Of course, the constraint, if you exclude all the F sigma 8 measurements, are much quicker. However, it still appear to be quite strongly prefer a higher growth index.
This gray curve is exactly what I was asking for. This figure is not in your paper, right? This is...
Yeah, no, this is just me trying to answer, you know, like questions I got from people recently, or actually questions we also asked ourselves, because we really wanted to account for the correlations between the local F sigma 8 measurements, but we haven't really come up to with a way to do that. So the poor man way, the best way we could do right now is just to drop out these measurements.
It's a shame you didn't include this in the paper. I mean, I guess you were aiming for a letter, so you kept it short. But the red and gray curves here tell a very compelling story, which is that, and you know, like one of them doesn't have F sigma 8, the other one doesn't have DESY 1 and BAO, and they're both at some level of sigma preferring a larger gamma, which is, I mean, very compelling. I guess one would still want to know that this is a this is not pushing the DES data into a region where it doesn't want to be, if that makes sense. That one needs to know that DES and Planck are consistent with this large value of gamma. Essentially, to see that those 2D plots where you had the S8 and gamma, and see that there's they're overlapping when you don't include them, like just DES and just Planck, and show that they're overlapping, and not that they're like they're here, and at 3 or 4 or 5 sigma they overlap. I'm just wondering, because a lot of the solutions to the Hubble tension do exactly that. They kind of have two data sets that aren't matching, and you go to an extra parameter, and then in the deep in the tail of the two data sets, they have evidence for this new parameter, but it's not in a consistent, and you haven't shown it isn't the case in this plot. I'm not saying it is the case. It's probably true that they're still consistent. So I find your result very exciting. So I'm putting my very hard skeptic hat on to see where all of the possible problems might be, so that
any skepticism is welcomed at this point. Actually, we still question our conclusion, and we still try to find ways to dissect the data and try to learn more about the implications, or try to answer the questions that you have been asking.
So I mean, this gray plot is one of the questions answered. Yes, with just DES alone, it also favors a large gamma. I guess the next question is it doing so in a way that is consistent with both DES and Planck, or is it forcing them both into a region they're inconsistent?
Yeah, that's a very good suggestion. Also, I think one potential follow-up that I would like to immediately investigate is just to replace the Planck data with either ArcNW map or some other combinations, because the preference for the negative curvature or higher A lens will only found in Planck later. So
yeah, so where do we go to next? You kind of already went into that a little bit. You want to have a look with ACT and WMAP perhaps, but what else? Yeah, what on the large scale structure side might be a new improvement to your analysis, and maybe on the theory side? Certainly one thing I want to ask you is, as you've said yourself, gamma is just a parameter. One would want, let's just say you're completely correct and gamma is not 0.55, What is the fundamental physics that might be causing that? Are there ways that we can like examine specific modified gravity models to see what might be happening?
So let me answer your first question. So on the data side, since we started doing this, I've been looking more and more into peculiar velocity measurements because for the same reason that I think you can guess. And then I'm very excited because it turns out that I learned that all of these ongoing and upcoming large-scale structure surveys are also doing peculiar velocity measurements. And I think going in towards the future, having a joint analysis of cross-correlation between peculiar velocity brought by these large-scale structure surveys and the CMB lensing brought by future CMB experiments definitely will clear up this debate or question. And what is important is just the synergies between these surveys, so how much they overlap. And then I think the second factor, or maybe equally important, would be how do we handle the systematics in these peculiar velocity data. As for the implications on the theory side, to the best of my knowledge, I think it is not straightforward to map a growth index value that you infer from the data to the theory space, but it can give you some sort of directions because it's actually not straightforward for modified gravity models to allow for a scenario with suppressed rows. So finding a suppression of rows already points you towards a subspace, a much smaller subspace of modified gravity models. So this is also one reason that we have been checking our results very carefully because naively, a priori, I wouldn't expect to find a higher growth index or suppressed rows.
Why not? I mean, like, it feels like a super naive question. One could just increase it or decrease it. What's the difficulty of decreasing the strength of?
I'm definitely not an expert on modified gravity, but just from talking to modified gravity people and also reading this very recent review from Jiaming, which I don't know if it's on the archive yet. I don't think so. What we found is like there's not much modified gravity models that predict suppression of growth. Most of them would predict actually a higher F sigma 8 at low redshift.
I'm just wondering whether that's physics reasons or sociology reasons that people in the past have tried to build models that increase growth of structure. But that's an interesting thing to flag up, though. So I guess the other question I kind of asked is about fundamental physics models. You've partially answered that by saying it's difficult to suppress the growth. Do you know of which subset? You said there's some subset that might work. Which subset is the attractive subset? Are there any models that are just like the model builders are now, I don't know, like throwing parties saying, finally someone's detected my model?
Yeah, so again, I'm definitely new to this whole modified gravity business. But as mentioned in our paper, there seems to be a subset of Hodensky class of modified gravity models that quite robustly predict a suppressed F sigma 8. So the difficult thing, I think, is that having a suppressed growth rate while having a similar expansion history to lambda CDM, which we constrain very well, and which we also find that in totally consist our result is totally consistent in that regard. So then it's difficult to find a suppression approach from modified gravity models. So we did a little bit of literature research, and we found some papers or works that we indicated in our paper as an example for these type of modified gravity models. And we ourselves are also investigating this class of Hodensky models ourselves. Just the difficulty is that it's to sample this Hodensky subspace is also very numerically expensive, and a lot of these models are actually not stable. But we are also excited about that aspect, and we are actually actively working on that.
I'm excited to see the results. So okay, before I ask you the last question I ask everyone, I'm gonna ask one other question. And yeah, can you put your own skeptic hat on as firmly as possible and do something that is unfair to ask you to do, but like tell me the most compelling reasons why this might not be correct. Like, what if 3 years from now, we're looking back and saying, oh yeah, you know, like Min had a great paper, but it's a shame blah 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 happened and it wasn't a detection of new physics. What were the reasons that it didn't work out? Like,
Yeah, so this is the question I think I ask myself, or we ask ourselves every night since we posted the paper. But very quickly, I think two reasons might be, and they're all systematics related. But I think one is that we are essentially driven by systematics in this new peculiar velocity measurements, or we are either that, or we are driven by the systematics in the Planck data. But I also mentioned that I would like to repeat this analysis with independent CMB data.
yeah, your independent one with just des and BAO kind of sort of rules out that you're driven by systematics in F sigma, right?
Yeah, so the CMB is what I would go to next, and especially because the residuals from the best fits models all look the same.
I don't remember where I heard this first, so I can't attribute it to anyone, but there's the well-known saying that you should not believe any model until it's backed up by data. The converse is actually equally true. You shouldn't believe any data until it's backed up by a model, because there's so many ways that one could have made a mistake, and not just you guys in your analysis, but systematics before the data even gets to you. And once you have some compelling model that kind of fits everything, and you've taken a small step, because gamma is a kind of phenomenological model, but at least it is a model. It's not just attention. It's like saying, okay, here we're kind of honing in on what might be causing it. And it's the other super compelling thing is that it's kind of saying stuff about two tensions at once. There is this funny A lens thing, which you're helping with, but then there's also this very, very funny S8 thing that you're helping with. But yeah, the thing that would make it extremely compelling would be if some person said, hey, here's this model that is independently interesting for compelling reasons that we've been working on for the last 10 years, and it does exactly this change in gamma, then one would be like, ah, okay, this is interesting. I mean, this is more interesting, it's already interesting.
Right, so I absolutely agree with you that we are trading here two tensions for one, and we essentially just offer a new interpretation for these two tensions. We are not really solving anything, so we are now very much hopeful of like an explanation from the theory side. I think this is the disadvantage of just looking into the data and try to see what the data tells you. It doesn't give you an explanation. And then on the other hand, what is also interesting or concerning is that the growth index and the growth index parameterization is a very well-defined quantity and parameterization within linear theory. So it's fair to use that to confront linear data. However, it is not always guaranteed that these F sigma 8 measurements, for example, from the data, efficiently isolated linear regime from the nonlinear regime. Because a lot of nonlinear modeling to go into these measurements, for example, to model the nonlinear redshift spray distortion. So that would be another concern of mine, which is whether the F sigma 8 measurements essentially just come from the linear regime.
Yeah, and but to, yeah, so someone would have to redo the whole DES pipeline right from the beginning with some modified gravity model the whole way through. I mean, it doesn't change the fact that your first result is worthwhile and interesting. It's just whoever comes next has to up the game. Cool. All right. What work being done in cosmology at the moment do you think is particularly underappreciated by the community?
Yeah, so I think this question, the answer to this question, just chancing I wrote this paper, because since then I've been looking more into measurements of peculiar velocity, or using peculiar velocity to do cosmology. And I think it's fairly underappreciated, and I actually perfectly understand, coming from working mostly with just simulations. I think it's easy to just throw our hands up in the air and say that I don't trust peculiar velocity measurements. They are so messy, a lot of systematics. But I think to be productive, we should collectively work toward improving the modeling. And actually, I believe these systematics are not fundamentally impossible to model. For example, a lot of selection effects, like the scatter in Tully-Fisher relation or the Malmquist bias, can be, in principle, model within a forward modeling framework or a choice Bayesian inference. So that is where I think is promising. Also, I guess I'm probably biased because I come from the forward modeling community. But I think this is a compelling case for forward modeling. And then you can also think of using new props of peculiar velocity. So now we have Act, which measures very well the CMB data, and then also the secondary anisotropy, CMB anisotropy, which is the kinematic pseudo-absorptive effect, for example. So we can think of using this to trace the velocity field in the future.
If your result holds up, then this might be the beginning of the community's obsession with peculiar velocities.
Even if it doesn't hold up, I hope it motivates the work in this peculiar velocity department.
Okay, cool. Thanks everyone for watching. If you like this, please do subscribe and click the bell if you want to be notified of new videos, and click like to help with YouTube I always stumble over that. Click like to help with YouTube algorithms, both for yourself and for the channel, because YouTube will know to recommend more like stuff like this to you. While you're here, you can watch another video if you want. Last week's video was also on modified gravity and peculiar velocities, taking data from simulations to see if one can predict what the value of the modified gravity parameter was. And it might be that that sort of work with taking actual fundamental physics models that have modifications of the growth rate of structure and therefore peculiar velocities will be where things are going next. And that, yeah, I mean, this was on F of R models and DGP models, but maybe some F of R model or some DGP model is responsible for this. And yeah, thanks, Min, for the great talk.
Thank you, Sean.